Hey everyone, and welcome to Saint Online. It's great to have you with us.
To stay up to date, hit the like button on this video and subscribe to the Saint YouTube channel.
Enjoy the service. Hey everyone, and welcome to Saint Online. It's great to have you with us.
To stay up to date, hit the like button on this video and subscribe to the Saint YouTube channel.
Enjoy the service.
And a very warm welcome to church. Whether this is your first time here or you're here every Sunday, it is good to gather together as the people of God and to worship. Whether you're watching online or you're with us here in the room, we are so glad that you're here.
How's everyone?
How is everybody doing? Good morning, everyone. Welcome. We're going to stand together as we come to worship, and we're going to have a lot of fun this morning. Why don't we stand and let's pray as we gather. Heavenly Father, thank you that you're with us today, that you love us. Thank you the sun is shining. We thank you that you are on the move here. And we pray for each one of us that you'd meet with us today. Come and fill us with your Holy Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Continue our worship with a time of family worship. So kids, if you would like to come down to the front, kids team, kids volunteers, come help us with the actions. We are going to worship as a whole family. And so whether you are 5, whether you are 50, whether you are 105, this is a moment where we all do the actions, we all get involved, we worship with our whole body. And this morning, we're going to be singing My Lighthouse. So if you know nothing else, just walk around in a circle and you'll be fine. It's going to be a great time. Worship team, over to you.
Your great love will lead me
to your seats. Thank you so much. Can we just encourage our young people for leading us? So good. Why don't we remain standing just for a moment if you're able to, and we're going to pray for the world. It won't have passed your attention that we are, the world is in a mess. We need to pray. And we pray for peace regularly. We pray for the Middle East, particularly quite often in our prayers here as a church, praying for the people of Gaza, praying for an end to hostilities, for peace and reconciliation and healing. But today we really want to pray. The world is in quite a dangerous position right now. And it's always like that. Jesus is in control. He's in charge. He's the King of the universe. And we're going to ask him to bring peace. And so why don't we just take a moment and just pray for the world today. Father, we ask for peace. Prince of Peace, would you bring peace in the Middle East today? We pray for the people of these nations, people of Gaza, the West Bank, people of Israel, the people of Iran today. We pray that there would be a turning of the heart of those in authority from war to peace, from hatred to healing, from destruction to reconciliation. We ask, God, for those who are making decisions right now, that you would turn their hearts, that they would bring about lasting change. And we pray for the vulnerable today, for those who are going to be impacted, for the orphan, for the widow, for the children. Lord, would you impact those who make decisions, that the poor be lifted high, that those who are vulnerable would be prioritized, and for an end to conflict, we pray. And Father, we thank you that the universe is in your hands, that you are the Prince of Peace, that you're the Lord of all. And we pray today for an end to violence, in Jesus' name, amen. And then we're gonna pray for ourselves closer to home. We pray for the beginning of a new school term. We pray for the kids, some of them over the road right now, packed into the den doing youth right now. Just loads of good things happening in our kids' work. In a moment, kids are going to go over the road, but we're going into the summer term, some kids facing exams. Let's pray for the children, the young people in this church today, that they would know your love. Father, we ask that they would experience the love of God today, for our young people to know peace, to know your assurance, know you with them as they go into their exam season, for those who are doing exams, for the start of a new school term, that you'd be with our young people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Would you turn to the person next to you, just give them a quick high five. If you're online, just click your mouse. That's all you can do.
And would you like to take a seat? In a moment, we are going to turn to the screens as we check in on all that's going on in the wider life of the church. So if you'd like to take your seat, let's check in on Saint News.
It's Kat and Robin here with this week's Saint News.
Yeah, and first up, we'd love to invite you to the Awakening Project, happening on the 1st to the 3rd of May here in East London.
The Awakening Project is a gathering of emerging leaders who united in a desire to see an awakening in our generation. It consists of 3 days of worship, prayer, teaching, connecting, and a lot of fun.
We're partnering up with loads of incredible people and organisations to make this happen, including our friends over at KXC, Imprint, 24/7 Prayer, Revive Europe, Fusion, and lots more.
So you can register your interest, head to saint.church/awakening and find out more.
And on Friday the 3rd of May, we've also got our all-night joint prayer gathering in Hackney Church, starting from 7 p.m. going away all the way through the night until 7 a.m.
We did this last year and it was absolutely incredible, and we can't wait to pray and worship through the night again, gathering with Imprint, KXC and other friends from across London. So we will see you there.
And next, we have our Saint Super Sunday coming up on the Sunday the 12th of May in Hackney Church. Now, Super Sunday is a chance for all of our saint locations and services to come together and celebrate what God has done and continues to do in our church community.
So usually we meet across multiple locations and services, but on Super Sunday, we're all gonna be meeting in Hackney Church at 11 a.m. for one joint service. This will be followed by a big community lunch in the gardens, along with a prayer and worship gathering in the evening at 5 p.m.
And so this means that there will be no services on Sunday the 12th of May, other than the Super Sunday gathering at Hackney Church. It's going to be amazing, so pop the date in the diary, Sunday the 12th of May. We can't wait to see us all gathered together as one saint family.
Next up, House of Prayer is back tomorrow night in Hackney Church House from 7 p.m. House of Prayer is a community of people from our saint locations and beyond that gather every Monday night to pray and worship together, pursuing God's presence as a community. So we will see you there on Monday night.
And finally, if you've never been baptized before, now is your chance. We've got our next baptism services happening on Sunday the 21st of April across East London. So email us at hello@saint.church to find out more and to sign up.
That's all for this week's Saint News. We will see you very soon.
Fantastic. Just a quick one on the Awakening Project. We'd love your help. We are expecting several hundred leaders from around the world to spend those few days, 1st to 3rd of May, with us. Real practical ask, if anybody has a spare bed, we have leaders from all over the world coming. If you've got a spare room and you can like put someone up for those 3 days, your family, you've got like a sofa bed or a spare room, we would love your help. We have about 40 people who are flying in who currently don't have anywhere to stay, and I think we'd just love help. So if you're a family here and you have a spare room, the person to see is Matt, who is waving at the back. In fact, Matt, why don't you come and do a lap really quickly so everyone can see you. You're going to have to run, though. Run as I, that's it. So catch Matt later on. Matt is the guy. He gets a clap for that. That's amazing. Okay, so come and find Matt. If you've got a spare room, a sofa bed, if you could put someone up, he would love to talk to you. Obviously, there's all sorts of processes we've got to go through, but we'd love your help if you have spare space.
Amazing. We are going to continue our worship and prayer with our giving liturgy. And if you've never been here before, we've noticed that people give in so many different ways that we don't want to just pass a bucket round. If you're a regular giver and you give online or you give on your way out by dropping something into the white box or tapping the Izettle, what we want to ultimately do is be a people who bring our generosity into our worship. And so if you'd like to stand, we're going to say these words. They'll come up on the screens together as a prayer. Ultimately, it's a posture of our heart, encouraging us to be a generous people in all that we do. So we say together, Lord, we give joyfully because you have held nothing back from us. Lord, we give generously because we want to become like you. Lord, we give sacrificially because we want others to taste the life of your kingdom. Father, receive these gifts and use them for your glory. Amen. Amen. And in a moment, as the kids head out to their groups and we say hello to one another, a QR code will come up. And if you've never registered before to give, you are so welcome to do so, but you are under no compulsion. So if you have never been here before and you're like, I have a kid, where do they go? Follow the orange t-shirts. We have kids group for everyone from 0 all the way up to 11. We've got a Hey Baby Room across the way with a live link where if you have a small toddler who wants some space, they can have some space and you can watch a service. We've got fun kids activities for all primary school age kids, and we even have youth. So kids, if you would like to head out to your groups, and adults, if you'd like to say hello to the person around you, ask them how their week has been. In a moment or two, we'll gather back together and continue our worship. Thank you.
please stand together? Would you like to jump to your feet? And we're going to come to worship. Let's take a moment just to pray, be still. Father, we thank you for your very great love for us, that while we were far off, you came to meet us in your Son. We thank you that you love each one of us unconditionally, that you're for us, not against us. And we come to you today as broken people. We've got lots of stuff wrong, God, we know that, but we know that you're gracious and kind, and you meet us in the person of Jesus. And pray for every single one of us this morning that as we come and gather, that your presence would fill us, that your word would inspire us, your spirit would guide us. We welcome you this morning. Lord Jesus, we say we need you. This world needs you. We need you in our lives. We need you, Jesus. You know the struggles that we face, the anxiety, the concerns of every heart in this room. Come and fill this place. Fill your people from the front to the back of the room. We welcome you.
Let your word darkness, my God, that is who you are.
We're going to just continue to worship. Psalm 27 says this: "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" Verse 4, "One thing I ask from the Lord, only this do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life and gaze on the beauty of the Lord and seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock." Verse 7 continues, "Hear my voice when I call. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not hand me over to the desire of my foes, or for false witnesses rise up against me, sprouting malicious accusations. I will remain confident of this, that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is a stronghold of my life. Whom shall I be afraid?" We're going to hear from Matt in a moment and, you know, read the Bible and preach and all that kind of stuff. But just before we do that, we want to just linger in the presence of God. And sometimes, you know, in the Bible that you and I read, the translation, there's a word in the Hebrew which is translated in the kind of NIV, the text that we tend to use, most contemporary translations, as "praise the Lord," often in capitals. And in fact, you look for your Bible, you'll see this phrase over and over again: "praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord." But in the Hebrew, there are a bunch of different words that are translated. Somebody was just like, "Hey, we can't explain these words in three words. We're going to translate them all as praise the Lord." But they mean a whole load of things. I mean, to like, to grieve before God, to weep, to bring your sorrow and your suffering. One of them, Tehillah, means to sing in the spirit, to overflow with songs from the heart, adoration. Another one of these words literally means to wave back at God the promises that he has made over your life, like reminding God. So they'd call it a wave offering. They'd stand before God and they'd write and wave before God the promises that God has spoken over our lives. And you may be going through a time of trouble today, and man, life is full of troubles. Jesus is like, there's a few things Jesus says that we want to kind of skip over in the Bible. One of them is like, "In this world you will have trouble." It's a promise. I don't know how many of you got that highlighted in your Bible. Pray that one to being. But the world is full of trouble. There's moments when we go through grief, or we go through suffering, we go through anxiety and sadness, and we feel anxious about the world, illness. And often at the same time, they come along with great blessings and excitements and breakthroughs. But as we often say, they're like two train tracks. They go parallel. It's not like you're immune from battles when you experience blessings. They go together. And certainly when you look at your life, and I'm sure it's the same when we look at each of our lives, there are moments when we feel like celebrating with joy, and the moments we feel like weeping and grieving. And the two are not incompatible. But as the church, the people of God, what we've got to learn to do sometimes is remind ourselves that we stand before God, reminding ourselves of his promises to us. And so what I'd love to encourage you to do, if you feel comfortable, you don't have to do anything, but why don't we get a bit old school, a bit Old Testament this morning, and let's lift our hands if you're comfortable, and just like, if it's not too cheesy, a bit weird or whatever, let's just begin to just like lift our hands to God. Maybe pick one promise in your life that you know. Hey, it could be just verse 20, verse 1 of Psalm 27. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And as we sing this one more time, our God is an awesome God. And don't you love it when a song starts, it's not on the stage, when the Spirit leads our worship? But why don't we just sing this and let's lift that promise back to God this morning, that even though we walk through the valleys of hard times, that you are my light and my salvation. I won't be afraid. You're the stronghold of my life. Or whatever the promise might be for you today that you're clinging on to, for healing, for breakthrough, let's lift our hearts and lift our hands. Let's lift our voices. Let's keep going. Let's press into the promises.
He's an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Lord, we hang on to your promises. We thank you for your faithfulness to us. We thank you that you are love, that you are good, you are kind, and that you're on our side, you're with us. We pray you'd encourage us, each of us today, to go deeper in our faith with you, to walk more closely with you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Guys, what happens? What keeps happening? Like, we're gonna stop worship like ages ago, and like, the Lord just keeps hijacking it, and you keep hijacking it. It's brilliant. Don't stop being church. We love you guys. It's so good. Just wonderful sense of God working in this place. So grateful for you guys, and keep praying, keep going. Love to welcome Matt Orr, who's going to come and speak to us this morning. Matt is a student pastor here and oversees the work we do now with really 11 right through to kind of mid-20s. Amazing. I mean, hundreds of young people involved across the week in our services. If you're here and you're new, this is one of our 14 services taking place today, and they vary in different ages and stages, but we have a real priority among the emerging generation. We really believe in investing in, particularly among young people here in East London. It's really important that we invest and encourage them in their faith early on. Hands up if you became a Christian before you were 21 years old. Just raise a hand. Okay, so quite a few of us experienced Jesus as a young person, and we want to make sure we pass that baton on to the next generation and invest and encourage them. So Matt leads an amazing team and is a great guy. So Matt, why don't you come and encourage us this morning? Would you welcome Matt?
Thank you, guys. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. A heads up, we're going to be going to Matthew 28 very shortly. But I want to ask you a simple question this morning. Are you ready to take the plunge? Are you ready to take the plunge? The past few weeks here at Saint have been incredibly beautiful. As we journeyed to Easter, we went through Holy Week, walking together all the way to the cross, the tomb, and the resurrection. Taking time to reflect, to pray, and to celebrate the wonders of Christ crucified and the freedom brought about by resurrection power. Not only that, but we celebrated all our crews. We got together for our end-of-term crew party to play some silly games, eat some amazing food that wasn't pizza, and thank God for the way that he's moving through this community. And last week, we had the privilege to hear from some new voices as the gang absolutely brought it with the squad preach across our locations, championing and celebrating and challenging us as they encouraged us with post-resurrection encounters with Jesus, the risen living God. For us as a church, it's been a real season of joy. It's been a real season of celebration. And I want to encourage us not to see these points as mountaintop moments, but rather firm foundations to build upon. So I ask again, are you ready to take the plunge? As mentioned, next week is Baptism Sunday. And if I'm honest, baptism services are always my favorite. There's something incredibly profound about a community centered on Jesus, committing their children to the Lord through dedications and infant baptisms, inviting the grace of God upon their lives, and committing to praying for and with them, committing to discipling them in the years to come. Equally, it's such a powerful witness when those who are old enough to make personal decisions to follow Jesus publicly make their commitment known to the world and proclaim resurrection life in Jesus' name as they rise up out of the waters. These services are holy. These services are sacred, and these services are always filled with so much life. And these are days you never forget. The 4th of June, 2017. Believe it or not, it was a Sunday, the day that I chose to take the plunge. One of the best days of my life. And I'm aware that many in the room today have probably already been baptized, but by the grace of God, as our church continues to grow, as the Spirit continues to convict hearts and save the lost, I've no doubt there's plenty in the room who've never even considered baptism. So this morning, I want to take us on a bit of a journey from Old Testament history to New Testament spiritual reality, speaking to those of us who have already been baptized and those yet to be, knowing that this morning there is an invitation for us all as we encounter Jesus through his living word. And it feels fitting that off the back of Easter, at the back of the squad preach and the post-resurrections encounters, we're going to turn to Jesus' final words in his Gospels to his followers. So as we come to read Matthew 28, would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, we know you are here. You are good. You are God. We invite you now to rest in our hearts that we may receive from your word. Lord, make us open to hear what you want to say and work in our hearts so that you can work through our lives. Come, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We're reading Matthew 28. We're going to kick things off in verse 16. And as we know, Jesus is risen, he is alive, and he's about to meet with his disciples. And we read, "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, this passage is probably familiar. It's known as the Great Commission, and it sets out the simple instructions to go, baptize, teach, and obey, knowing that Jesus goes with us by the power of his Holy Spirit. And it's the common calling for each and every one of us. It's the common calling on all of our lives. And it was this commission to these 11 disciples that has brought transformation to countless lives, cultures, and communities, including our very own. Where the gospel has been proclaimed, the good news of Jesus has been told, where people have encountered Jesus by his Spirit and have been set on fire to live for his kingdom and not their own. And I truly believe baptism is a catalyst for this. But it's so much more. So let's look back so we can understand where we're heading. As I said before, historical narratives in the Old Testament, the stories that we hear, often hold spiritual truth and realities in the new. So where have we seen the waters of God in the Old Testament? Well, it's right there from the very beginning. Genesis 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the earth. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. From the very beginning of creation, water holds significance. We know it's a sort of life. It sustains us and it helps us grow. That's as true for us as it is for the rest of his creation. But interestingly, when we think of the biblical narrative, the story of the people of God, when we think of water, we might be more drawn to think of destruction. For example, Noah's Ark. We know the story, the world has turned away from God. So God sends the flood in order to start again. And we read in Genesis 6, now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. God said to Noah, I'm going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens. Every creature that has breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish. But I will establish my covenant with you. And you will enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you. You are to bring into the ark two of all living creatures, male and female, to keep them alive with you. We know the story, but do we recognize what we see here of the waters of God? For in this story, the waters of God, they kill, they destroy, and it rids the earth of anything set up against God. And yet, God saved Noah and his family, the ones who were left in right relationship with him. He brings them life, restoration, and salvation through the waters of God. And we see this time and time again in the Old Testament. We see this in the Exodus narrative, where God sends 10 plagues to the people of Egypt after Pharaoh, who was seen as a god in his own culture, refused to recognize Yahweh, refused to recognize God, refused to release God's people, the Israelites, from slavery and from captivity. And through Moses, if we know the story, God parts the Sea of Reeds, often called the Red Sea, and he takes his people from bondage into freedom. From certain death to life, from the old and into the new. But more than that, if we know the story, the Egyptians aren't happy. They hunt them down, they pursue them, and they follow them into the waters. They follow them into the Sea of Reeds. And whilst there was freedom for the people of God, there was also destruction of those set up against the Lord. Exodus 14, the water flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen, the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them, the Israelites, into the sea. Not one of them survived. But the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall on their right and to their left. That day, the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses, his servant. The waters of God, they kill, they destroy, they rid the world of anything that is set up against God. And yet it brings freedom, new life, and salvation. And that's just a foretaste of the baptism yet to come. For when we are baptized, when we enter into the waters of God, we die to sin, to shame, and to self. We rid ourselves of anything not of God, anything not of his kingdom, anything we've done wrong, anything we've got wrong, and we're washed clean. And when we rise up out of the waters, we rise in resurrection and restoration to new life and to a new identity. Knowing that one day, like Jesus, we will rise again into glory and into eternity with the living God. The Apostle Paul puts it like this in his letter to Romans. He says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. So are you ready to take the plunge? And if you're here today and you've already been baptized, let me rephrase that question for you. Having been baptized by water and filled with the Holy Spirit, are you living in that resurrection life? Are you living in the freedom that he's given to you? Are you waking up every day, rising out of your bed, rising from your slumber, knowing that your sin and your shame are paid for, the old is gone, the new has come, that you've been washed clean and filled with his Holy Spirit, so that you may go and carry out the great commission that Jesus gives us, that you too may proclaim the gospel so that others may repent and believe and taste the life of his kingdom, that they may be baptized and taught to obey his good commands found within his word, making disciples of all nations, knowing that he is with us, even to the very end of the age. If you're here today and you've been baptized, you need to rise every day, be filled with his spirit, and carry out the good works he's laid before you. And if you've not yet been baptized, if you're hearing this for the first time, I want to suggest three real simple truths as to why you should get baptized, either next week at our baptism service or one to come in the future. And the first is the most obvious, it's the most powerful, it's the most simple. Jesus tells you to. Jesus was baptized and the Spirit was poured out. His identity was made known, and God with us showed us the way. For God never asks us to do things that he's not already done. John the Baptist said, "I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." And we see this in the early church. We see this on the day of Pentecost, where 3,000 people give their lives to the Lord. Having heard the gospel, having encountered the Holy Spirit, the people were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized." And about 3,000 were added to their number that day. The early church, they went, they baptized, they taught and they obeyed. And Jesus is asking the same of us. Jesus tells you to get baptized. Secondly, we want to celebrate you. The 4th of June, 2017, as I said before, one of the best days of my life. It was filled with so much joy and so much love. It was also one of the best missional opportunities we're ever going to get, because friends and family, people that we know, are going to come along and celebrate you and what God has done in and through your life, even if they don't usually come to church. And actually, I have friends who came to my baptism. It was a bit rogue. I basically invited everyone I knew at school, just come along, it's going to be sick, you should be there, come watch me take a bath. It's a weird invite, 180 people watching you get dunked, strange times. But friends who came along who had never been to church and haven't yet been since, still talked about it years on. Post-COVID, we had a get-together at my family. We invited all our friends and some of the people I hadn't seen in years. And one of the first things they wanted to talk about was that time they came to church and they saw me get baptized. It's one of the best missional opportunities, and we want to celebrate that. And historically, baptism was your welcome into the family. It was your welcome into the church. As we read in that passage, 3,000 were added to their number. What's that number? It's the people of God, it's the church, it's who they belong to. And as you die to your old self and receive new life, we want to celebrate you. We want to pray with you, and we want to commit to journeying with one another all the way into eternity with Jesus. Jesus tells you to, we want to celebrate you. And finally, and this one might be tough to hear, any reason you have as a follower of Jesus not to get baptized is probably a lie from the enemy. You see, God longs for you to be baptized, but the enemy definitely doesn't want it to happen. As I mentioned, baptism is often a catalyst in the kingdom. It's a significant part of the Great Commission, and it's an integral part of following Jesus. And there are spiritual consequences. You see, in the church today, it feels like we have a little bit of a crooked, warped view of baptism, because we either hold it too high or we hold it way too low. We either think it's only for those really good Christians, the one who are really going after it, the special Christians, the really keen ones, or we think it's not really that big a deal. I've been following Jesus for years. It doesn't really matter. I've missed the boat. But neither statement is true. Jesus said, therefore, go baptize, teach and obey. It's central to discipleship. It's a catalyst for the kingdom, and it's a part of the calling upon each one of our lives. And the beautiful thing is there's a grace over baptism, whether that's adult or infant. Because I was christened as a child, and although I didn't grow up going to church or in a Christian family, I was baptized, christened at 2 years old, and then lived my life not knowing Jesus all the way until I was sort of 18, 19, when I first met Jesus and had a personal relationship with him. But on the day I was christened, I was committed into the Lord's hands. People committed to praying for me, and years later when I met Jesus for myself and gave my life to him, I took the first opportunity I could to reaffirm my baptismal vow, to take the plunge and step into the resurrection life. Jesus tells you to. We want to celebrate you. And any reason you have as a follower of Jesus not to get baptized is probably a lie from the enemy. So I ask again, are you ready to take the plunge? And in a moment, we're going to pray and we're going to invite the Spirit of the living God who's already here, who's already moving, who's already at work. But if you're here today and you've never been baptized, you've, as an infant or as an adult, we'd love to have a conversation with you. Grab one of the gray Connect cards that were on your seat. They're probably now under your seat. Grab one, fill out your details, tick that you want to be baptized, and at the end of the service, go along to the Connect desk, the welcome desk over there, and hand it to Nye, who's going to receive it personally, and she's going to have a conversation with you. We'd love to have that conversation. And finally, as we sort of draw this to a close, I want to acknowledge that although physical baptism is linked to receiving the Holy Spirit, we see in the Acts of the Apostles that this isn't always the case. Some may be here today having been baptized in Jesus' name, but never having welcomed or received the Spirit of the living God. Equally, you may have already received the Spirit, but you're yet to be baptized. You still need to be baptized. Fill out the Connect card. Let's have that conversation. But just as Peter and John prayed for the new believers in Acts 8, who had believed and been baptized, but were yet to receive the Holy Spirit, we want to make space to pray for you. So why don't we stand? We're going to respond together. And if you're usually on our teams that pray, I'd love to invite you forward now. Don't hold back. Don't waste time. Because God comes where he's wanted. He stands at the door and he knocks. But he always waits for us to respond. So as the prayer team come forward, as they line themselves amongst the stage, I'm just going to invite the Spirit of the living God to meet with his people. And if you feel comfortable, why don't you close your eyes? Why don't you lay your hands out as if to receive a gift from your Father in heaven? It's a physical sign of a spiritual reality. And it helps us focus on him. And we're going to pray, come, Holy Spirit. Spirit of the living God, come and have your way. If you're here today and you've never received the gift of the Holy Spirit, if you've never encountered the living God, I encourage you, come forward, be prayed for. We'd love to lay hands. Often in the early church, it was a sign of the Spirit coming when the hands were laid and people prayed. Don't hold back, don't wait. And if you want to receive prayer for anything this morning, we'd love to pray for you. The Lord's been speaking in many ways through the worship, through the word. But don't miss out on this time of encounter. Don't miss out on the opportunity to receive more of him. Calm, Lord Jesus.
As we continue waiting on God, listening for God, being present to God, we are going to continue our time of worship. We're going to sing songs that invite him in. We're going to sing songs that recommit ourselves. The sense I had this morning as Matt was talking is that for some of us today, it might feel like a wedding, like you're getting married for the first time, like God is saying, hey, would you commit to me? For others, it's more like a vow renewal. Like there is an opportunity to say the words that I said or the experience that I had years ago, it might have got a bit quiet, it might have got a bit dry, but God, I want to give myself back to you. I want to live out the truth that is on offer through the baptismal vows that were made. I want to live out the freedom and the new life and the new creation that you have on offer for me. And so we're gonna say yes and amen. We're gonna sing louder than the things that we feel disqualify us or make us unworthy of that love and that freedom. And we are gonna worship with our whole hearts.
We're going to continue to worship a little bit longer, and do feel free to hang around, say hello to somebody you don't know. The kids' pickup is in a few minutes' time over the road, but let me pray the blessing as we go out from here today. And just a reminder, if you've never been baptized, go see Nye, who'll be at the desk at the back, and she'd love to chat to you. We got a load of people getting baptized next week. You're not going to be on your own. It's going to be really fun. Like Matt said, if you were baptized as a child and you want to reaffirm your baptismal vows, we do that as well. That's a great way to kind of mark in ink what God has done in pencil in your heart and your life. And so I'd love to encourage you to do that if that's you. And you can do that. Go chat to Nye. It's very relaxed. It'll be really fun. So come and see us. Let me pray the blessing as we go out into the beautiful sunshine. Isn't it great that it feels like summer is here? It's not raining outside. It's sunny. It makes all the difference. Let me pray. When they saw him, Jesus, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. Surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." The blessing of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, be with you, go with you today and always. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. See you next Sunday. Come and say hi as you leave. Enjoy the sunshine. See you soon.